The power of hell forever defeated. This is the word, here in the flesh, living among the meek and lowly. The voice of God, his every breath, salvation of the
is very special because we have a baptism service today. Woo!
Hey. I think we can do better than that, can't we?
Yeah.
Should we try again?
Try again.
We got baptism service today.
Hey.
Yay! And if you are visiting CLC today, coming to support your friends, your family, you are very, very welcome. Very welcome. So, big wave from us and enjoy.
Yeah, brilliant. So shall we stand together? We're going to start with some worship. I'm just going to pray and then we're going to head into it. So Heavenly Father, thank you for this special day, God, that we get to be together. And God, I pray that you'd bless this morning as we worship you with all we have. Amen.
This thing I know,
thank you, Jesus, that you are worthy to be praised. That you stand above all, that you hold all together.
Jesus.
And God, it's as if that all we can do, all we can possibly bring is this act of worship in surrender to say thanks to our God who stands above it all. Thank you, Jesus. So I pray that God, that you come and meet us where we are this morning as we continue to seek your presence and to enjoy being together. God, I pray that you keep meeting us where we are. Amen. Amen. Why don't you take your seats for a little bit? We're going to just give a few announcements and then we'll keep going. I've forgotten my thing again. So the first announcement is, keep it quiet over there, please, shout. The first announcement is that this week starts our week of prayer. Ooh. So when you leave today, you can collect one of these. It's got all the information in for this week. But I'll just quickly go through and Jess is going to help me as I go. Okay. So Monday to Friday, 7 o'clock in the morning, we have a prayer meeting on Zoom.
On Zoom.
And then on Wednesday at
11 o'clock,
we have a
prayer time here, prayer meeting here.
Yep. Specifically for those that are in prime time, but anyone can come. It's communion and it'll be a great time. And every morning as well, we have the church building open for personal prayer reflection.
Personal prayer and reflection.
Wednesday night, we have our prayer meeting here. And then Sunday, we have our big celebration.
Woo!
Yes, Celine, I'm so pleased you're in today. Celebration, prayer and praise evening. I think that was it.
That is. And straight after that prayer and praise evening, we have the return, are you ready, of Toast. Woo! For the young adults and students. So after that meeting, we'll be gathering. It's going to be a social time. And we're going to eat some toast. So that's going to be great. That's going to be every second and fourth Sunday evening, straight after this time, straight after service, usually 7:30.
Brilliant. And so now we're going to invite Dad Paul, Pastor Paul Hudson, to
Dad,
come and speak. I think
Pastor
I nailed
Paul,
that. I think I did really well
leader.
Then.
Thank you. Good. Thanks, Pastor Jason Becker. They've put me over here because I don't want to be over here. I want to be in the middle. But they're thinking that I might fall in. You're hoping I might, eh? So somebody nodded then when I said, you're hoping I might fall in. Yes. It's nice to see you. And if you're visiting today, if this is your first time, you're very, very welcome. It's nice that you've come to see your friend drown. So you're thinking, what's going on here? You may have heard of christening, where you know babies are sprinkled. We don't do that here. We do dedicate babies. We thank God for them, and parents give them back to God as a gift from God to them, and they rededicate their children. But what we do practice is we practice baptism based around a person's faith and their understanding that they want to follow Jesus Christ. And so we have several, how many, this eight, and this morning, so there are eight individuals who today are saying, I'm going to declare publicly that I am following Jesus Christ from this moment on. I mean, they've been following Jesus before this, but they're declaring it publicly in this act of baptism, which Jesus asks us all, commands us to go through those waters of baptism. Who's been baptized? Do you remember your day of baptism? Well, hold on. There was three hands that put their hands up there. I mean, one of them was Dennis. I expect an elder to put their hand up, you know. Good, so we're looking forward to that. So those at home, Hi, and hope you're tuning in right now. We're going to open our Bibles. I'm going to share with you, continuing a series that we have been focusing upon over the last few weeks from Colossians chapter 2. While you're finding that, Colossians, it's going to come on the screen anyway, but Colossians 2. Just to let you know that next Sunday, Stuart and Amanda Blount will be here. Stuart's going to be preaching. Do anybody remember Stuart? So if you've come to church, if you come to CLC in the last 5 years, you might be thinking, oh, I don't know who they are. Well, 5 years ago, they left. They've been pastoring here 22 years, loved within the church still, and it's going to be great to have them back with us next Sunday, and as he will continue this series. I love this place, don't you? I love this church, don't you? I love this church, don't you? I love this church, don't you? What I love about it is that it's like it's full of all different ages, isn't it? You know, this didn't work on the first service because Dennis wasn't in, so I'm going to do it again. But I looked this morning, and I looked at Charlotte. I thought when she's playing the keys, Charlotte looks really young. It's great, you know, to have young people, isn't it? How old are you? 20. Never ask a lady how old she is, but she's young. And then I looked at Dennis. For all ages, and it's tremendous, isn't it? And I'm hoping on Wednesday morning to meet those prime timers. I don't even know what prime timers mean, but I'm hoping to meet them. And I guess it's those people who are having the prime of their life are going to be here. But if you're not a prime timer, come anyway, 11 o'clock. Colossians chapter 2, let's read. It's coming up on the screen. Paul says this. Paul's writing from prison, and he's writing to a group in Asia Minor, and he's saying these words: I want you to know how much I am struggling for you and for those at Laodicea, and for all who have not met me personally. My purpose is that they may be encouraged in heart and united in love, so that they may have the full riches of complete understanding, in order that they may know the mystery of God, namely Christ, in whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. I tell you this so that no one may deceive you by fine-sounding arguments. For though I am absent from you in body, I am present with you in spirit and delighted to see how orderly you are and how firm your faith in Christ is. And these are the next two verses I want to focus on. Verse 6. So then, just as you receive Christ Jesus as Lord, continue to live in him, rooted and built up in him, strengthened in the faith as you were taught, and overflowing with thankfulness. Amen. Just want to say how I'm just thrilled that we can now translate for our Spanish friends. And we've got Juan at the back there. Juan, are you doing a good job there or not? Juan, are you doing a good job there or not? Spanish, are you understanding what he's saying to you? Okay. Did he read from Ephesians or did he read from Colossians? He's in the Old Testament. Oh my goodness. I'm just so delighted that we're able to do that. I'd love the church to have headsets for every language that's coming. There's so many different nationalities here and it's wonderful. And I like those headsets. I should be preaching. Why am I talking to you like this? I like those headsets. You know, in the United Nations, you can just flip a switch and it can go to whatever language you want. That'd be great. If you get fed up of English, flip it over. Flip it over to another language. See if the preaching improves. Flip it over. Okay, let's get back. Let me read two verses again. Verse 6, verse 7. Claw it back a bit. So then, just as you receive Christ Jesus as Lord, continue to live your lives in him, rooted and built up in him, strengthened in the faith as you were taught, and overflowing with thankfulness. Can I tell you, if I could just put into a nutshell what this man, Paul, sat in prison, writing to a community of believers miles away, he's saying this in one sentence. And I don't know what your situation is at all. I don't know what you are going through, what you're facing, but it is this. This is what Paul is trying to say. He's saying then, is this. You are going to make it. Whatever situation you are finding yourself in, you're going to make it. He's writing to a group far away, and he's saying, listen, I've not been to you, but I'm telling you this. From what I've heard about you, I know you're going to make it. And I'm saying to you this morning, you are going to make it. It's not going to be because you are pursuing a pipe dream. It's not going to be because you are better than anybody else and that you've achieved some gold standard. It's not going to be because you are holier than anybody else. It's not going to be about any other achievement. But it's going to be about one man's achievement, and that's Jesus Christ. And I know that you're going to make it because of Christ Jesus. I know you are going to get there because of Jesus. I know that if you've got Jesus in your life, if you are following him, that Christ is enough for your life and that you are going to make it. When you wake up in the morning, you're thinking, I don't know if I'm going to get through this day. I'm telling you right now, you're going to make it because Christ is in you. And he that's in you is greater than he that's in the world. And the person that's above you and underneath you and at the center of your life is Jesus Christ. And the message this morning is that you are going to make it, my friend. You're going to make it. Now, let me tell you what Paul says. He says to us in this passage here that you're going to make it not because of fine-sounding arguments. In fact, if you focus your life on fine-sounding arguments, if you focus on your life on vision statements, rhetoric, dialogue, discussing philosophy, discussing this matter, that matter, trying to work out who's right and who's wrong, and trying to defeat every argument. If you base yourself upon that path, then that's going to deceive you. It's going to take you away from the truth of Jesus Christ, who will enable you to get through this life. Fine-sounding arguments are not going to be the answer. Religion is not the answer. You may be full of religion. You may be full of the rules. You may be following religion. It's not going to help you one iota. But Jesus Christ is going to make the difference in your life. He is going to bring you through. He is going to get you to the end. He is going to carry you and bring you through all the storms of your life. It is not religion, but it is a relationship with Jesus Christ. Amen. Is there anybody here today? CLC, we are here not for any other reason but for being a follower of Jesus Christ, being disciples of Christ. Our successes are not in what we achieve, but what Christ has achieved in this world. And the achievement of Christ is, as you know, the death of Jesus on a cross, 3 days later, rising again. And that powerful historical truth is still important powerfully today for you, for me, for the world that we live in. Paul, isolated in prison in Rome, writes to these enforced, scattered individuals who have got all kinds of problems going on in their life. And they're wondering if they're going to get through persecution. There are places in the world today, and the church is just wondering, am I going to get through this? Are we going to make it through this? You may be coming to church this morning, and you may have all kinds of problems. You may be facing a great challenge tomorrow in your life. I'm telling you this, that you are going to make it because of these three things. Firstly, you can continue in Christ. Paul says, you received Christ Jesus, continue to live your lives in him. You will remain in him, you will make it because you can continue in Christ. People may have stirred malicious lies against you. They may have whispered your name, gossip may be all around you, but you can continue in Christ. In 1995, I made a phone call. I have felt impressed upon me to make a phone call to someone that I didn't know, really. He was my regional leader. I was just a pastor of a church. I got impressed to call him. He was my regional leader. He lost his job. He was put on the scrap heap of life. His own peers walked away from him. He lost all his friends. Everything that he knew, he lost everything that he knew. And me, I just only started out. I'd been a pastor for 3 years, and I got enough courage to phone him. And my words to him were this: I believe you can continue. I believe you can go on. And I helped that man do just that. And that man continued for another 22 years. You may be on a scrap heap of life where your past is better than your present. And I don't know what put you there. And I don't know what took you there, whether it was your sin or whether it was the sin of other people. But you may not be where you were once. You may have... Your best may be behind you. And I'm telling you this, is that you can pick yourself up and you can continue because of Christ Jesus. In 2001, I received a phone call from someone who had been on my staff as the pastor of the church. And we had to remove him. And he phoned me. And I remember I've never been so intimidated by somebody's voice down a phone call. And his message to me was this: I am going to bring you down. And this individual had a really, really good go at it. Publicly, in the papers, everything, stardom. And but I found this, I found that I could continue. Your circumstances may threaten you, and vivid pictures of your own demise. You may be worried about tomorrow, and there's the enemy of your soul, Satan, will come with all of his demonic forces to sow seeds of doubt and fears upon you, saying, you're not going to make this, you're not going to do this, you're not going to get through this. I'm telling you this, and my testimony is this, is that you're going to make it, you're going to continue. You can continue in Christ. In 2012, I walked out of a hospice, having journeyed with an individual that I loved, a member of my church. He was only 52 years of age. The whole church gathered around praying for him, for healing, and we believed for healing. And I was in the hospice, and I prayed with him as he went into heaven. And I walked out of the hospice, and I started to cry. I was standing in the car park before I got into the car, and I said to God, that's it, I'm finished. You haven't answered, and it's all over. I can't do this anymore. And I just felt God just say, shut up, Paul. Something like that. And I found this, I found that I can make it. I found that I can get through this. In 2017, the man that I encouraged in 1995 to go on and continue, he became my mentor, my friend. He journeyed with me for 22 years. We traveled the whole world in missions together. And while I was on holiday, I got a phone call one evening, and his wife called me from the church where my friend was preaching. My friend was preaching, and during the middle of his sermon, he just dropped down dead. And she called me and said, he's gone. That was 4 years ago. And all the last 4 years, I've needed that individual in my life. I've needed a conversation with him time and time and time again, but I've not obviously had that. And I've wondered whether I could continue. I wondered whether I could get through. I'm standing to you today and saying this. It doesn't matter what's gripped you. It doesn't matter how trapped you feel. It doesn't matter how final it might seem to you. It doesn't matter what comes against your life. It doesn't matter whether it's grief and sadness. It doesn't matter what storm of life shakes you and causes you to freak out a little bit. I'm telling you this. If you have Jesus Christ in your life, if you're standing on Christ, if you're with Him and following Him, you can make it. You will continue in Christ, because Christ is in your life, and He that's in you is greater than he that's in the world. He is turning nightmares into dreams. Listen, this person, Apostle Paul, who wrote these words, also wrote this. We are hard pressed on every side. Don't think this is easy for us, but we are not crushed. We are perplexed. Does anybody know what it is to be perplexed when you don't understand what is going on? We understand what that is. We are perplexed, but we're not in despair. We're persecuted, but we're not abandoned. We're struck down, but we're not destroyed. We are continuing. That's the message of the Bible, is that we are continuing. The message of you, the message of my life, is that we are continuing. We are continuing. You try and strike the church will rise, because at the essence of our life, at the essence of our being, is resurrection life. That's our message. With Jesus, we may die, but we rise again. Amen? The one who took you in is the one who brings you out. The one will see you through. All right, secondly, he says we are rooted and we're built in Christ. This is the reason why you're going to remain. This is the reason why you are going to make it. It's because of your roots. You don't just believe in Jesus. You don't just pray to Jesus. This is not that kind of a religion. You don't just turn up at church, sit down and do a few little prayers and just go through some songs and so on. There's nothing like that at all. Your life is rooted. I mean, you can imagine a tree with the roots. Your life is rooted in the personality of Jesus Christ. You are built upon a strong foundation of Christ. Amen? This is so much more than just a little religious duty. This is everything. And Paul tries to communicate this to us. In December 2004, any Indians with us today? Give me a wave. Pondicherry? Yeah, but you were a lot closer than we are. Whereabouts in India? Chennai. Love it. Love that place. Love Chennai. Fantastic. It's great. Pondicherry on the coast. December 2004. Great tsunami hits Sri Lanka, that whole area. It was just a dreadful. You remember it on the news? It's in your heart, you know it. And it just bombarded that shoreline. And this city, Pondicherry, has a population of 300,000 people. Outside the city, 600 people were killed because of the tsunami. Pondicherry, no one was killed. 300,000 survived inside the city. Outside the city, 600 killed. Why was Pondicherry saved? It's because of what happened 250 years previously. 250 years ago, when the French came in and colonized the city, they began some building work, and they began to build a sea wall. They finished building it in 1957, and it was 1.25 miles long seawall. When the tsunami crashed against Pondicherry, the inhabitants were saved because they had built this defense wall against that city. CLC, you're here. And you've survived the storms, and you're going to survive some more. We can't guarantee that you won't go through storms. Storms happen. to good people, bad people. Good things happen to good people, and bad people. Bad things happen to good people and bad people. It doesn't matter. In fact, there's not enough good in you. If you being a good person was enough to stop bad people, bad things happening to you, there's not enough good in you. There's not enough good in me to stop bad things happening. It's got nothing to do with that. It's life. It's just life. Storms will come. Storms of life will go. And you've gone through storms and you've survived. More will come. And I'm telling you this, the reason why you are still able to sit today in this church this morning, the reason why you are still able to praise Jesus today is because you've not just said a couple of prayers, but you have been rooted and you have been built in Jesus Christ. Amen. Your life is upon Him, and you are proving that actually, no matter what comes against us, we will be able to continue because we are rooted and built in Christ. Amen. That's why the Bible says the eternal God is your refuge. Underneath are the everlasting arms. Enemies will come, you face them. They'll beat against your life that you've built. All that you've built, all that you call our blessings, all that is beautiful in your life will be challenged to its core at some point in your life. But it will not bring destruction because you're rooted and built in Christ. Okay, let me go finally. You can continue in Christ. You are rooted and built in Christ. And you are strengthened and overwhelmed by thankfulness for Christ. That's what Paul says there in Colossians 2, in verse 7. That rooted, built in Christ, strengthened in the faith as you were taught, and overflowing with thankfulness. Maybe this morning you need to be strengthened. Maybe you are just facing the challenge of your life. Maybe you're standing today and there's intimidation for tomorrow. And you're saying, Paul, I need to be strengthened. Maybe you need to perhaps get a hold of the Bible and pray. What it says in Nehemiah 6 verse 9, it says, when Nehemiah was rebuilding, it says those people were trying to frighten us. They were trying to tell us that we're not going to complete this, that we're too weak for the work. But I prayed, Nehemiah says, I prayed, and my prayer was this: now God, will you strengthen my hands? And maybe that's you today. Maybe you just need to come before God and say, God, I pray this word. I pray, God, strengthen my hands. But perhaps the only way for you to get through your grief and your sadness is to be strengthened. And maybe you need to pick up the Bible and pray it. Pray Psalm 119, when the psalmist says, my soul, you see, is weary with sorrow. I've got so much sadness. God, will you strengthen me according to your word? Perhaps the only way for you to face the greatest ordeal that you've ever faced on this earth is for you to be strengthened, and you need to do what your Lord Jesus did when he went into the garden when he was facing his greatest ordeal. Luke 22 says, an angel from heaven appeared to him and strengthened him. And maybe some of you this morning just need to call upon God and say, God, will you strengthen my life? And he will, because you have got someone who knows what it is to need to be strengthened, Jesus Christ. I pray today, right now, Lord Jesus, for every man and every woman, every young person, child in this place, this morning. Lord, whatever tsunami is coming against their life, whatever challenges they're facing, whatever difficulty it is, Lord, I pray that they may hear this word, that they are going to make it. I pray that, Lord, they'll continue. I pray that, Lord, rooted and built in you, Christ, their life is secure on the rock. I pray, God, you'll bring them through as they're calling upon you even right now to be strengthened by you. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Friends, you're going to make it. Some people trust in chariots and horses, the Bible says in Psalm 20, but you and I know a name. The Bible says, Isaiah says, woe to those who go down to Egypt for help and they rely on horses and chariots. It's a description of everything that the world can bring. They're not going to find the strength that they need. And there's many places that they can go to, Isaiah 31. But you and me, we look to the one who is higher than all names, name above all names. Like the chronicler in chapter 32, the kings of the world, they only have the arm of flesh, but we have found someone who helps us and who fights our battles. And I'm here today and I'm saying that his name, the name that we have discovered, his name is Jesus Christ. We will continue. We are rooted and built and we will last. We will get through. We will make it through this season. We are strengthened, overflowing with the thankfulness of what Christ has done in our life. Amen. Amen. May God bless you. May God bless you. Okay. Amen. Let's stand, shall we? And let me ask you just to be quiet for a moment. Do you need the strengthening arm of God? Do you need help? Do you need Christ? Then he is here alongside you right now. Every man, every woman, every child, every young person. Whatever you're going, those at home watching, whatever you're going through, whatever tsunami, whatever you're facing, Christ is the answer. Christ is the answer. Thank you, Lord. If you need Jesus right now, if you need supernatural God to intervene in your life, just as every eye is closed, as they're trying to be free from distraction, why don't you just lift your hands just in worship? Just saying, God, I need you right now. God, I need you right now. That's it. Just do that. God, I need you right now. I've heard a message that I can continue. It's my own strength, but in your strength, I need, so fill my life with your presence, O God. In Jesus' name. Amen. If you need to talk to somebody before you leave, you can talk to any of the pastors or any of the staff that are helping us today and do so. Please sit down. We're going to move into the baptism part of the service, and I'm going to help organize that now. So, now I'll move over to my allotted place. Aha. Good. So, great. So what we're going to do, we're going to hear... Who loves baptisms? I love baptisms. Don't you love baptisms? Get ready, because we're possibly going to have a little dance at the end of this service. Possibly. Okay, so we're going to hear from each of the candidates. Looking at Jason and Becca, are they all here? We tick, tick, tick. Brilliant. So, we're going to hear just a short testimony from each one, and they're going to come stand with me as I call their name out. They're going to come in that order. So, the first person we're going to have out is Jody. Well, this is Jody.
Hi, Jody.
You can take your mask off and if you want. Jody's a swimmer, so it's okay now. Yeah. Just when you're ready, it's fine, Jody.
Hi, everyone. Hi, everyone at home as well. Just a bit of background if you don't know me already. My name is Jody. I'm 18 and so blessed to be part of the CLC family for all of my life, basically. So I'm just going to get started. I just want to start off by saying how thankful I am to say that I've grown up in a loving, supportive, and Christian household. So from a young age, I have learned all the amazing stories about Jesus and all the miracles he did. And as I became slightly older, I started to realize that knowing about God wasn't enough to save me. Although I didn't have to do anything physically to save me, I had to trust God and give him my whole life, which is quite scary for a young kid. But when I was 11 years old, I said yes to Jesus and accepted him into my life for the first time. But from then on, I still wanted to be in charge and tried to handle a lot of stuff by myself. So I limited God to Sundays and did what I wanted with the rest of my week. Most of the time, I was too focused on other people's opinions and perceptions of me. I prioritized pleasing people instead of pleasing God. Struggling with fear of rejection, loneliness, and anxiety. Sorry.
It's okay. You're fine.
Sorry.
So it's good. It's okay. It's good. We're not afraid of our emotion, are we?
No.
Not at all.
You're all right.
And what do you have to go swimming today? Do you have to go swimming? What time do you need to go swimming? I'm just thinking.
Right now.
No, seriously, do you have to go time later on today?
No.
No, I don't need to go home at all. So take your time. We're here all day. It's fine. So just relax. Yeah. We're all right. We're good, aren't we?
Hey, Jordan. Sorry, guys. So, struggling with fear of rejection, loneliness, and anxiety, I thought I had to do whatever I could and attempted to create a false image of myself so that other people would accept me. I felt conflicted with my faith, where it definitely flailed at times. I was never completely satisfied and tried to fill the void with distractions and addictions. I started to realize that I saw in my own strength, I could never find an identity where I wouldn't fear what others thought of me. I couldn't rely on my own strength to live. I needed something bigger and that could sustain longer than myself to depend on and heal my brokenness. One of my favorite verses where God speaks to Paul in 2 Corinthians 12, it's taught me to rejoice in my suffering and to not be ashamed of my weakness, because Jesus already took and bore the pain for me when he died on that cross.
Amen. So good. So good, Jody.
It reads, "But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses, so that Christ's power may rest on me. That is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in weaknesses, in insults, in hardships, in persecutions, in difficulties. For when I am weak, then I am strong." I thank God that he has convicted me of my own sinful nature and shortcomings, because he has given me the strength I need, and I can rejoice knowing his power to overcome. When I say this, I'm reminded of John 16, verse 33, where Jesus says to his disciples, I have told you all of this so that you may have peace in me. Here on earth you will have many trials and sorrows, but take heart, because I have overcome the world. God has continued to reveal himself to me through his word and fellowship, wherever I found a hope and purpose for my life, found peace in his goodness and grace, and encouraged that I no longer have to be a slave to shame and fear when I allow God to work in and through me. As I make my decision to be baptized today, I have accepted Jesus Christ as the way, the truth, the resurrection, and the life, the name above all names, my one true personal Savior, who loves me unconditionally and takes me as I am, and I give all the praise and glory for that. Taking this next step into my journey and relationship with Christ, I ask you with love to pray for me to increase in his Holy Spirit and grow a more faithful and obedient servant towards his kingdom, sharing love and the gospel to those around me. My ultimate hope is not in this life on earth, but in the eternal hope of being in partnership with my Lord and Savior in heaven. Thank you.
Wow. So good. So good. That was just an awesome testimony. And that is exactly about being rooted and built in Christ. Jody, let me take the microphone. You go and sit down and wait for your baptism to take place. And we're going to have our next testimony. Whoa, we got off to a great start. Oh, we got a great start. Our next testimony. And we've got Dawn. Spiritual Dawn.
Morning. Oh, afternoon, church.
Yeah, afternoon.
Okay, I'm ready. So I'm Dawn, as some of you may already know. And my family and I have been at COC for 17 years. So since I was a newborn, so I'm 17 years old. With that, I obviously grew up in the church, and I went to Sunday school. Age 12, I started youth, and I'm still at youth now, and I'm a leader in training at youth, and I help with the kids program, and I do vocals on the worship team as well. I first said yes to Jesus at 12, even though I was surrounded by the church and Christian family. At that age, I was more mature, and at Limitless Festival, I was surrounded by so many people in my age group just worshiping Jesus, and at that time, I knew I had to be more independent with my relationship with Jesus, because it has no business with any other person but yourself and him. And since that moment, I've had my fair share of ups and downs. It hasn't been plain sailing whatsoever. But when I think of it, I realize that it is a part of his plan for me. And I know that in the end that he will make a way, and it will all turn out fine. And I guess that's why I follow him as well, because I know I'm promised that spot in heaven. And the main question today is why I want to get baptized. And a specific moment really outstood all the others. And it was very recently, a few weeks ago, I took a test which is required by universities for students who want to study medicine or dentistry. And usually when I take tests, I tend to dwell on the worst outcomes, and I stress and I get in my head all the time. And I never focus on the good possibilities, and I kind of put Jesus to the side. But for some reason, on that day, I said, you know what, I'm going to keep Jesus at the center. And I'm going to let him do his work. I don't need to stress. Keep a positive mindset. And after knowing my result, I didn't feel sad. I didn't dwell on the worst. I was at peace. And I guess that's why I want to get baptized. It's more of a representation that he will always be in the center of my life. And also, with it being live streamed and in front of the church, I'm making this public so that I show that I'm not ashamed of my relationship with God, and I'm not ashamed of the gospel. So I'm going to finish with this verse that just really ties it all together. And it's Psalm 138, verse 8. The Lord will work out his plan for my life. For your faithful love, O Lord, endures forever. Don't abandon me, for you made me. Thank you.
Wow. That's so good. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thanks, Dawn. Now, thirdly, we have Beatrice. Beatrice. Wow. Thank you.
Hi, my name's Beatrice. I am 17, turning 18 in October. Basically, I have grown in a Christian home. All my family is Christian, especially back home and that. And my on my mom's side, my uncles are pastors. My late auntie, she was also a pastor. Over my life, I've been going to church and all, but the only reason I would go is like, oh, just to meet my friends and all. And when they told stories and that, I would just be like, oh, I already know this. But I have came to CLC before because my dad's job would tend to move around a lot. So we lived here and we used to come here. But when I came back, I was afraid to go to youth because I was afraid that maybe God would expose me of what I was doing to someone. But I remember it was 1 or 2 years ago, we were in youth and we're in the middle of praise and worship, and I just started randomly crying. And I did speak to someone about it, and she prayed for me, but then I fell back into the world again, because I'm the sort of person who over my life I've built myself on based on what people think. And I've tried to change myself to be who I'm not. And even now I struggle with those things because I've done it for so long. And it hasn't been easy. But I remember I told Becca about it and she told me that I'd probably encountered Jesus, which was cool. And I gave my life to Jesus in December last year, but it hasn't been easy because I remember when I first started, I would spend a lot of time, I would isolate myself in my room, I would spend a lot of time crying, I would ask why, but it's gotten better over the time, and there are still things I struggle with, and because I've been used to doing things my own way for so long, it's really hard to like do what he wants me to do. But I thank him because even over my life as well, he's the reason why I'm still here today, because I don't know if I would be alive today because of some things that happened in the past. And I think it was like a few months ago or so, I remember I was coming out the bathroom, and because the lock screen on my phone, I didn't really notice that at first, but there's a Bible verse, Isaiah 41 verse 10. And it says, fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I'll strengthen you. Yes, I'll help you and uphold you with my righteous right hand. And I remember that I did ask him to help me, and the part that says, yes, I'll help you, that stood out to me. And I just hope to like maybe progress. And the reason I want to get baptized is because I want a new start and to learn to be more obedient and to change that.
Fabulous. So good. Brilliant. So, we're doing well, we're doing well. Brittany. Brittany. Thank you.
Hi, my name's Brittany. I'm from Bermuda, if you want to know why I talk like this. But I'm just going to keep it short and tell you why I want to be baptized and why I follow Jesus. Okay. I want to be baptized today because I have decided to follow Jesus and want to let everyone know that I believe God is real. I believe Jesus has got me through many situations and he will never fail me. His love for me is amazing and he is so good. I follow Jesus because he died for me and he has forgiven me for my sins and he has given me the chance to have a relationship with him.
Wow, thank you so much. Family. Brittany, you're from Bermuda. Is that, wow, isn't that amazing, isn't it? Okay. Next, we have David. David's the tallest of our baptismal candidates. Here we go.
Thank you. Hello, church. Good afternoon. My name's David. I'm 18 years old. And yeah, so from young, I've obviously been born into a Christian family. Like, my mother and my dad are both Christian, so we've always knew about Jesus, like, from growing up, and Jesus has always been, like, a part of our lives. I gave my life to him at a very young age, like, I would say around about 7, but you know when you go to church and they say, if you want to follow Jesus, say, repeat this after me, I was just repeating it every time. So I would say the first time I done it was around 7, but maybe, like, around 10 was when I was old enough to, like, you know that I wanted him in my life. So as I grew up, like, God showed himself to me in many ways. Like, he's showed me so many signs, and like, there's not a doubt in my mind that I know he's real. And I just want to, like, follow him and declare to the world that this is actually real, and that's how I want to choose to live my life. So I want to get baptized because Jesus was also baptized, and he encourages us Christians to get baptized also. And ironically enough, lockdown was like the turning point for me. So it's not like I was living a bad life before that, but lockdown, because I was working and commuting to my warehouse job every day, I was listening to Elevation Church on YouTube. So I just, like, drew closer to him every day, just learning about him. And, like, I just felt like he was really there, like, yeah, for me. Yeah, so I just want to finish with this scripture that really spoke to me when I read it. It's Psalm 127, and it's the NLT version. It says, unless the Lord builds a house, the work of the builders is wasted. Unless the Lord protects a city, guarding it with sentries will do no good. And that just spoke to me because I know how much we need God in our lives. Like, we can't walk this walk of life on our own. And yeah, that's all I have.
Wonderful. Great. So good. Well done. Great. Okay, number 6, Wanza. Yeah.
I'm really nervous, sorry.
You got this, Wanza.
Yeah, don't be nervous.
You
did great.
Pastor Paul says that when he found out I was being baptized, he was like, asking if I have a song and dance to do with it. And I said, like, he can be my backup dancer if he wants to. But that didn't work out, so.
I'm ready. just bring it on.
My name's Mwansa, I'm 18. And my testimony is about how my relationship with God gives me so much joy and reassurance. I'm really nervous, sorry.
Don't be, it's okay, breathe.
I'm the type of person who can get very emotionally overwhelmed with, like, anxiousness, discouragement, worry, and it becomes a very heavy burden to carry all by myself. So over the past year, I've learned the importance of spending time in God's presence, like reading my Bible and worship and things like that, and just being honest and vulnerable with him. Like, God wants us to cast our burdens unto him, as Jesus says in Matthew 11, verse 28, says, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. So, yeah, that's what I've learned over the past year. And I've learned that God loves us so much that in return that he gives us peace, joy, comfort, and reassurance. And that's a promise he gives to all of us. And it's just been really life-changing for me. And it's allowed God to work in my life and renew me as a person. And the reason why I want to get baptized is two reasons. Number one is because of my gratitude for Jesus. And because of him, I have this relationship that brings so much joy in my life that I didn't have like before. And other things were just really temporary, unfulfilling. And then the second reason is because I want other people to see our baptisms and see how much Christ has done for us. And I want others to give Jesus a chance and experience his love as well. So I'm just going to end on my favorite Bible verse, which is from Isaiah 40, verse 29-31. And it says, he gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary. And young men stumble and fall, but those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary, and will walk and not be faint. See ya.
Wow. Well done. Well done. Well done. Well done. So, two more. Chanda.
I've left my notes on the iPad. I'm scared to reach it, so I might just have to freestyle it, you know. But yeah, I'll freestyle it. Before getting baptized, you know, we had a little meeting and they said, you know, to answer two questions. First one was, well, why do you follow Jesus? And for me, just a bit of background to how I even ended up at CLC. I went to CLC when I was a youth, as a teenager. And, you know, we had a really strong youth group. And, you know, there was a whole heap of us, you know, and Tony Irving was our senior pastor, and I had so many sermons and prayer nights and worship nights. There were so many seeds that CLC really planted in my life, but I was one of those unruly youths, you know. I wanted to leave church so bad. I wanted to do my own thing, you know. I was kind of tired of the Christian way of living, so as soon as I left CLC youth, I was like, yep, this is it. God, we've had fun. We've had good times, but it's time to do my own thing, you know, and so God just let me do it, you know, and it was good for, it was fun, and then, you know, as the years go by, walking without God, you kind of realize, you know, I just really felt empty, felt unfulfilled. You have, like, friends around you, and everything looks good on the outside, but inside it was really crumbling, you know. And then I just got to my lowest moment. This is about 6 years, really, away from CLC. And I was saying to God, you know, I've tried everything, every way but your way. Everything's just left me empty, you know. And so I kind of humbly went, I was like the prodigal son, you know, you spent your inheritance, you know, and I just said, God, I've tried everything but your way, so I'm going to try your way, and I'm going to give you the reins. And so it was just in my room, and I remember listening to a podcast from Craig Groeschel, and it talked about being a soul winner, and I just liked that phrase, you know, and so I just prayed the prayer, you know, help me be a soul winner, God, and gave my life to Christ. And so for me, I followed Jesus, because in the lowest moment when I literally just turned away from him, rejected him, where I felt alone, I really felt his presence for the first time. Like, I knew that he died for my sins 2,000 years ago, but that was the first time I kind of felt him there in the moment as well. So yeah, just feeding Jesus for myself and just having that personal moment with him, I began to see that, you know, he loves me. Even though I've, like said, rejected him, turned away from him, after everything, he still called me, you know, and I just felt him just love me in that moment. And then that was it, you know, that was the moment I was like, yeah, I'm going to follow you. And so, yeah, because he loved me, I follow him, man. And the second question is, why do I want to get baptized? So I feel like that moment was about 2.5 years ago, and that was like the start of a season for me. And so I said that prayer. And on the other side of things, like I said, I had a strong youth group, and there's a friend of mine called Seth Sule. So shout out to Seth, because he went to our youth group, and we all kind of did our own thing, but he was the first one to come back to Christ, you know, and mature. And so I always looked up to Seth, and he was, as soon as I gave my life to Christ, you know, I started hearing these strange promptings, you know, and then one of them was to reach out to Seth. And I just thought, this is strange. We're not really close like that, you know, I don't really know him like that, but I ignored it for a few days, you know, and then finally I just kept getting irritated. I was like, okay, I'm going to reach out to Seth. So I told Seth, you know, this is what's happening, and I've just given my life to Christ again. And, you know, the thing I felt the Holy Spirit say to me was just mention youth leadership. And I was like, why would I mention youth? You know, I don't want to be youth leader. It's just, why would I give away my time like that, you know? But again, I mentioned it to him. So in that moment, you know, Seth, if you know Seth, it takes a while to reply in it, you know. He's very bad, but he took a few days to reply. After a few days, you know, he replied to me and he said, oh, sorry, I've been fasting social media. So I haven't been able to get to you. I've been fasting that my friends would come back to Christ. And so I so happened to be that friend. And so in that moment, it was like, I was, and one side of things, I gave my life to Christ, but the other side was Seth fasting and praying for me and other friends to come back to Christ. And so Jesus really started it with a bang, you know, started this new season with a bang. And since that moment, it's just been a time of him really undoing those years without him and building me up, showing me my purpose, and growing me, really just who he wants me to be. And so that's been my journey. I've just done the internship, and again, it's more building me in preparation. But I feel like in the last season, it was kind of like in isolation. And then now it's like I'm at a place where I can be proud of who I am. I can be proud. I've called myself Christian, proud that I'm trying to be like Jesus more every day. And so I think if I got baptized maybe 2.5 years ago, I would be kind of in my shell. But he's really just built me up, you know, and I kind of know who I am in Christ. And so that's been that season. So I've started a new job in a few weeks, 2 weeks, 3 weeks. And so there's a lot of new doors opening, and I feel like he wants to close it in style and close it in this way. So yeah, I feel like it's time.
So good. So good. Thanks. And finally, Jonathan.
Good afternoon, church. So for most of you who don't know me, my name is Jonathan Dave Salcido, and I've been, you know, Christian my whole life. My parents are Christians, my grandparents are Christians, and I just want to give a quick shout out to my grandparents. And so I've been part of the church for 13 years, so ever since I've been moved to Birmingham. And yeah, that's been that. And I'd say my personal life, my Christian life, you know, school's hard, being one of the only Asians in the school to start with. It was kind of like I was putting a facade to kind of like make sure that I fit in the in the school, and that's not been, you know, the greatest like way to do school really. And had like stints of the presence of God in church events, you know, back here in here and back in the Philippines, but nothing's really kind of kicked in until like a few years back, when, you know, God was starting to challenge me on the things that I'm doing in life and kind of like what the heart behind is whenever I'm serving here in youth and in worship. And through that, he's just challenged me so hard that I knew it was from him, because he was surrounding me with people that were like encouraging me, but also just giving further confirmation of the things that he's told me. And yeah, that's it really. And why do I follow Jesus? That's because he's given me a purpose in life. And he was there when no one else could. And he had the answers to when no one else could answer. And, you know, one of my favorite songs right now that's really like hit me hard ever since I heard it was, it's called Mercy. And one of the lines is, I'm so glad that my freedom isn't based on the things I've done, but the goodness of mercy and the power of blood. And yeah, and, you know, he's provided me with a lot of things. After uni, I was like, God, what am I doing? And, you know, I tried to open locked doors to where I'm like, okay, that's a no. Try to open another one, no. But then we sang this morning, it's just waiting on the Lord. And I feel like just start the pandemic, he was like, just be patient and I will make a way for you and I'll provide for you. And since then, I've been working part of the church, really. And so why do I want to get baptized is because I acknowledge that I've lived a a very, very sinful life. And, you know, he's done it all on the cross for me. And I just want to, you know, publicly declare my life. And I want to live a new life in him, and also want to be a living proof of the things that God has done, doing, and what he's going to do for me. And I want to show that to people I'm going to come across, to my family, my friends, and to everyone. And that is it.
Well done.
That's it. That's the eight, isn't it? So we're going to sing while Pastor Becca and Jason get themselves sorted, and then we're going to move into a baptism. Thank you. Just be careful now. Shall we stand? Shall we? We'll sing the song. Apparently, it's really hot in there. So, Jody. Jody. Okay, so when Jody gets in, we've got a Bible promise for Jody, and we'll have some pictures, and then Jody will be prayed for, and then she'll be baptized in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Okay. All right, you're okay? You're a swimmer. Come on. Well, this is great. So, Jody, your baptismal promise, that's on your certificate here. It's from Exodus chapter 14 and verse 14. Jody, it says this for you. The Lord will fight for you. You need only to be still. Isn't that beautiful? So good, isn't it? Okay. God, you're doubling up, aren't you? You're doing everything. Wanza. Fabulous. Picture time. Okay. Pray loud. How warm it is, Dawn. Feels good, eh? Okay, Dawn, we have this Bible promise for you. It's from Jeremiah chapter 33 and verse 3. It says these words. Call to me and I will answer you. And I will tell you great and unsearchable things that you do not know. Awesome. Photograph. Wonderful.
Heavenly Father, thank you for Dawn and this promise, God, that you're going to show her things, hidden things of this world. And God, I just pray that Jesus, you might reveal to her the depths of heaven, the joy of your presence. All of that which is eternal will come alive in Dawn. And God, as she makes this decision, I pray she'd be a witness to all those that she comes into contact with. Yeah. We ask this in your mighty name, Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
So Dawn, by the confession of your faith, baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Woo! Wow!
fabulous. We now have Beatrice. It's warm, isn't it? Beatrice, in your testimony, you spoke about a Bible verse and that was really important. And isn't it interesting that we have that Bible promise exact? The exact Bible promise. I'm going to read it again. Isn't that amazing? So Isaiah 41 verse 10, Beatrice, you know it very well. So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. And I will strengthen you and help you, and I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Let's have the photograph, then we'll pray.
Father God, I thank you for Beatrice. Lord, I thank you for that word over her life. That promise, God. And Lord, I pray, Holy Spirit, you would just come and fill her as she's baptized, Jesus. Lord, that you would just take the weight of striving for you, God, and fill her with your power and your might, that everything that she does is ordained by you and for your will. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Beatrice, on the confession of your faith, Lord Jesus Christ, we baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Yes! Thank you, Brittany. Yeah. Sure. Oh, great, Brittany. We have your Bible promise here, which is in Isaiah 40, verse 31. It says this: those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary, and they will walk and not be faint. Amen. Amen. Let's have a photograph here.
And God, we speak that promise into her life, that Jesus, if as long as she's leaning on you, that Jesus, you will renew her strength. I pray, God, that this might be the start of something new in her life, that you might open doors and make ways for her, Jesus, as she's making this public declaration to follow you with all she has and all she is.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
So, Brittany, by the confession of your faith, baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Yes! Welcome, David. Wow. Okay, David. This is your Bible promise from Romans 15, verse 13. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's have a photograph.
That's right. You can do it after we pray if you want. You're all right. Lord Jesus, I thank you for David. God, I thank you that you have your hand on him.
Yes.
Spirit of God, I pray that you would just do that work, that promise that was just given, God, it's only by you. And Lord, this declaration today, Jesus, thank you that David, with his actions, with his words, is proclaiming you, Jesus. So Father, fill him as we baptize him, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
David, on the confession of your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, we baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Yes! Change the photographer around a little bit now. Are you ready, Mwanza? Oh, very good. Bit of a cheer for Mwanza. Think warm. Okay, so so this is your Bible promise, and it's a powerful verse in Romans 8:31, and it says this: if God is for us, who can be against us? Amen? Well, great promise. Photograph. And Dad.
Heavenly Father, we just bring Mwanza before you now, God, and what an amazing promise that if God is for us, who can be against us? And so we speak that over Mwanza's life today, that if God is for you, who can be against you? In every season, I pray she would know the one fighting for her, standing with her, walking beside her. We ask this in your name, Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Yeah. So pinch your nose. That's it. You got it. So Mwanza, by the confession of your faith, we're going to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Yes. Yes. Fabulous. So, is there any more water left in there? Because we've got a big one now. Chanda, let's welcome Chanda. can do it. Okay, Chanda. Your Bible promise is from Ephesians 3:20. Ephesians 3, verse 20. It's a great one. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us. Amen. Photograph. Okay.
Let's go for it.
Yeah, pinch your nose. Right, stand quite forward. Father God, thank you for Chanda. Thank you, God,
yes,
that you called him back. Lord, that your love was all sufficient, yeah, that there's nothing separating him from you, because God, you made a way. Jesus, we thank you for all you've done in Chanda's life. God, we thank you for the call you've put on his life. And Father God, we thank you for that promise.
Yeah.
We thank you, Jesus, that you are for him. So Lord, go before him today, fill him afresh, and God, give him all that he needs.
Amen.
For your glory, God. Amen. In Jesus' name, amen.
Chanda, on the confession of your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, we baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Yes! Jonathan, we welcome you into the tank. Come on in. Yay. Okay, good, good. So, John, Proverbs 3:5-6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, submit to him, and he will make your path straight. Amen. Let's get a photograph here. Mom and Dad as well. Okay.
Heavenly Father, we just bring John before you right now. Thank you for that Bible promise that was given. Thank you for his testimony, that he is where he is today because of you, Jesus, because of your faithfulness towards him. And I just pray, God, that going from this moment, as he leaves the past behind him and steps into something new, that, Jesus, you might keep opening doors for him.
Yes.
You might keep making ways for him. And, Jesus, that he might just be a gift to the church and to who you are, Jesus. We ask this in your name.
So, Jonathan, Dave, Salcido, I baptize you in the name of the Father. Sorry, on the confession of your faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen. Yes! Woo-hoo! Nice to see our two pastors also got baptized. They are so, so wet, and that's good. Good. Okay. What a great, great baptismal service that was this morning. Amen. Did you enjoy that? A great time that was. We're going to finish on a. We've got these certificates, which will. Every one of them will get a one of these certificates. But we thank you for coming today. We're going to finish on this praise song. So please stand with me, and then we will close today and look forward to the prayer week. Make sure you get, in fact, Stanley, can you make sure that we have some of these on the door, and people can get them, so the prayer week. And right, didn't these do well today? Did these do well? All did well. All the young people did well. They all did well. Can I just say, we are looking for volunteers for Cozy Toes on a Wednesday, Friday. Can you see Natasha? Natasha, give us a big wave. Okay, Natasha's not going to let you leave the building. She's parking herself at that door. We need some volunteers. Please go and talk to her. We did announce it earlier a few weeks ago. We still need it. Okay, over to you. Let's finish.
We've got a lot to celebrate, church. So if you want to dance, go for it.
Greatest day in history. Tell this beauty you have rescued me. Sing it out, Jesus is alive. Across the empty grave, life eternal, you have won the day. Shout it out, Jesus is alive. He's alive. And oh, happy day, you wash my sin away. Oh, happy day.
As they leave this place back into doing their life this week, Lord, let them walk in your presence, let them know you more and more. In our prayer week, Lord, we're going to be seeking your face every single day, and God, we pray that you'll be glorified continually through CLC. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Great to see you.
There's no one like you. Mountains tremble when you speak. I'm listening. A whisper changes everything. Oh, mighty God. There's no one like you. Oh, mighty God. There's no one like you.
Your got nothing new. How could I express all my gratitude? I could sing these songs as I often do, but every song must end, and you never do. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again, 'cause all that I have is a hallelujah. Nothing else fit for a king, except for a heart singing hallelujah, hallelujah. I've got one response, I've got just one move. With my arms stretched wide, I will worship you. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again, 'cause all that I have is a heart.
Yeah. today.